First of all, welcome to our 4th annual Halloween costume. We've got some beer drinking and brat eating and fun. It's going to be great.
I'm very happy with the way God of War 2 came out. Provided we hit our mark, I was pretty confident that our sales would be better than God of War 1, but I was rather skeptical that our reviews would be. God of War 2, I think at the end of the day, probably equaled, if not slightly exceeded, the first, which I was not expecting, and it was quite satisfying.
I can't believe I'm fucking doing this.
I deserve this one, then.
This is the final chapter. So I think big goals for me are to finish this off in such a grand, epic fashion, something that is truly befitting of what we've done, what we've set up in 1 and 2.
All right, this is her revenge story.
God of War 2 ended up being everything we ever hoped it would be, and probably a bit more. It got reviewed very well. I honestly feel like it was probably about as good a game as is likely to be made on the PS2, and I'm very proud that we managed to do that.
One big family here at SCEA.
Once you start something, you gotta finish it. So that's the way I look at things. God of War 3 is gonna be the conclusion to the story. My hope is to make the best effects I can on the last one.
When I think of God of War, I think of the best action platformer out there right now. I think other games and other companies look at us and go, how are they doing it? How can we make it like them? And that's rad, because I've totally been at the company where we looked at that game and went, man, how do we do that, you know?
My main hope is that it escapes the destiny of sequels as well as God of War 2 has escaped the destiny of sequels.
I'm gonna be satisfied if we tie it all up and we can kind of close the book.
We're past the stage of figuring out what we want to do. We're now in the early phases of sorting out the how we're gonna do it.
Next Friday will be my last day at Sony Santa Monica. The bomb was dropped. It was somber and everyone was quiet and no one said anything, and perhaps there was a tad bit of shock. It's killed me because I really didn't want to say something, but it's just nothing you can say is going to come across as anything but you're an asshole.
When I heard that Corey was going to leave was kind of annoyance more than anything. It's, you know, takes a long time to make a successful team as much as a successful product. It's always a pain when a key person in that team decides to move on.
First emotion we felt was just shock. Didn't see it coming, didn't expect it.
It's like dropping a bomb.
Well, it was disbelief, obviously. I thought he would be the last one to leave.
Incredibly bummed out, like very, very disappointed.
You know, you're never really prepared for something like that, you know? They don't warn you very well either. They just kind of spring it on you.
It was kind of a bit of a shock. I never expected that Corey would leave the project, so. But once the initial shock died down, I couldn't help but being a little bit happy for him, so, because he was getting to try new things.
It kind of puts us in a little bit of turmoil for now, but I think we'll work it out.
I'm glad he has the balls to stick to whatever it is that he wants, but I'm also a little pissed that he's leaving us in the lurch, just kind of like holding the bag.
I mean, I know I want to be here. If he needs to be someplace else, that's what he's got to do. And I think it's better that it happened at this stage in the project than a year from now, obviously.
It obviously is a very difficult choice and a difficult time and not a very happy choice to be making. But, you know, on the horizon, the doors are opening.
Of course, it's hard to imagine someone stepping into Corey's shoes. He's amazing.
Many people wondered whether we could do God of War 2 without David Jaffe, who did God of War 1, and I think we succeeded at that. I think we can succeed at creating a third version without Corey Barlock.
I think it's kind of neat, actually. A different director for each chapter.
I have chosen Stig Asmussen to take the helm.
When I became director, there was a very warm response from the team. I got a lot of tons of support, and I mean, so far everybody's been super cool. I look back on how Corey handled things and how Dave handled things, and I draw inspiration. I think the most important thing that I got from both of those guys is the fact that they were themselves.
I'm super excited about this. You know, this team kicks ass, you know, and it's said a lot, but this type of situation, the kind of garbage that we've been going through in the last month, as far as I'm concerned, this team's second to none.
But Stig is fucking amazing.
Stig's a pretty good leader, I think mostly because you're probably afraid of him when you first meet him.
The entire team really respects him. Everybody communicates well with him, and he's not unfair with any of his decision makings.
From my perspective, he is much, much more easier to work with. He is much more structured and engineer friendly.
One of my strengths is to try to lead by example. Hopefully that filters through to the rest of the team and they're able to approach their tasks with total excellence.
All those leads from the last game, those key people, they're in place. And that's really where the personality of the studio comes from. That's where the drive of the team comes from, wanting to critique every element and make everything that's in the game the best that it can be. It really is driven from the leads and from the culture of this studio. And that has not changed, even through the turnover.
So working on the PS3 is very, very challenging. It's a lot of new technology and a lot of new techniques are required to make a game on the PS3, which means that we have to learn some completely new techniques for writing our game code. It's also a completely new graphics processor, so we have to learn about those graphics techniques and work out how we expose them to the artist in order to make the best possible art and give the game the look that the art team is interested in. We have a similar set of problems working with the designers. People's expectations for games on the PS3 are much higher. They want to see, you know, more enemies and more complicated effects and, you know, more ragdoll physics on the characters and, you know, realistic looking reactions when you hit people. So yeah, there's a tremendous amount of challenge working on the PS3.
God of War 2, the team was able to throw so many things into the game and get things up and running and finding out, is that fun or not? The hard transition for God of War 3 is getting all that to work again because we have so much new technology that has to be built.
You know what I'm saying?
Everybody has to relearn their own personal expectations and their limitations and how they're projecting their schedules and their tasks and things like that. Everybody is counting on everybody else to kind of make accurate predictions on what they can do. It's tough right now because everything's new. It's just so much more involved. That's very worrisome. When are we going to get to the point where we can say something's going to take 4 weeks to do and it's really going to take 4 weeks to do? It's understandable that nobody understands that right now.
PlayStation 3, we're able to push a lot more polygons, a lot more texture resolution and detail, so things are hyper-realistic. I mean, they're so realistic now that we can actually see pores on skin and hair and eyebrows and nose hairs. You can see everything. We have a lot of work ahead of us.
Every character now is like taking 6 weeks, eight weeks.
At least 6 weeks.
Yeah, to make one. It's not like before, it's like 5 days we can make one.
For me, it's not knowing kind of where the limits are. You can make stuff look so super realistic now, and that takes a lot of time. Whereas before, we really had defined limits.
Yeah, it's exponentially more complex. And the other big thing is, this is gonna be our first PlayStation 3 game, and we're expected to be able to beat games that some studios have released 2, 3, even 4. Gamers are expecting us to have better technology, better art, better visuals, better gameplay. Across the board, they expect it to be better. And that's pretty intimidating in itself.
We're going crazy with the detail. When it's done, I think it's gonna look incredible.
You're gonna see Kratos do a lot more subtle movement, more facial animation, things that the human eye just, you know, usually takes for granted, but now we can include all those things.
The things that we can actually accomplish are starting to now really become things that are only limited by our imagination.
With the new hardware and the new system, we're able to kind of start pushing the player experience and creating like a much more kind of cohesive world. And like, you know, the Titan before used to be in a cinematic and like, and now you're actually like running on the damn thing. So it's like, you know, whoa, you know, we're getting there.
Titans, we've never done anything like that.
They're pretty crazy.
It's insane. The fact that you're gonna be able to run around this like moving character and it's basically a moving level, it's pretty insane.
From a a programming perspective, they're a big challenge. We designed all of our animation systems and everything to deal with a roughly 2-meter-high character.
Exactly.
Where, you know, if his little finger twitches slightly, there's, you know, it's not too much of a big deal.
Exactly.
But when your character's, like, you know, 2 kilometers high, then a little twitch in the finger suddenly becomes like a really big deal. The very first moment those were mentioned, I was like, oh, Jesus, this is going to be a big problem.
Yes.
But hey, I mean, it wouldn't be God of War if we didn't try something we couldn't, didn't think we could do when we started.
Because I'm very proud of this game and you guys, I've invited a storyteller friend of mine to come in our walkabout. So Stan Lee is going to join us today and check out your work.
This is such a cool time to be just walking around the studio and looking at things as they're coming online. Every month, you know, we do a walkabout, and it's largely for the team to kind of, you know, review each other's work and, you know, and really compliment each other.
It's a big studio now. There's like 80 people here, and really it's impossible to keep on top of everything that, any given part of the group has been working on. It's an opportunity for everyone to see what cool stuff has been going on in the studio. It's a good way of making everyone realize that they're part of a big machine at this point.
Plus, everything looks better after you had a couple beers. So it helps to make your stuff look better.
Yeah, everyone's out to get
these are all Olympus, the gods, and they're all bad. All the gods are bad, except this guy who's tormented.
Yes.
That's he's great.
His line is, in the end, there will only be chaos.
And then the next game you do is called Chaos. That's a great sequel.
There you go. Zeus's brother Poseidon.
Terrific, terrific drawings.
Hera.
Yeah. I love to write dialogue. Maybe we could try something new. A video game with lots of dialogue. I'm sure it would sell like a bomb. And I love the way this hand is there. Oh, gosh.
Oh, yeah, and then when he moves the hand, we'll like make that to kind of get destroyed a little bit and get all kinds of dust flying off of it.
This is one of the best things I've ever seen.
Cool.
That is beautiful.
Last thing Corey did before he left.
Okay, so long, fellas.
We're just giving each other props here.
Yeah, yeah. Cheers.
There's no such thing as a bad walkabout, because, you know, beer at work.
And also, Stan Lee rules!
Woo, woo!
Just crawled up there.
It's Stan Lee.
Stan Lee!
I'm fine with this as long as we make it seem like it's in-game as much as possible.
I'm still learning every single day, and I imagine that that process won't ever end. And there's so many things that you can learn from every individual on this team.
Stig is kind of man of the team, you know, very easygoing, very casual, but he's also extremely intelligent, very thoughtful. I think the thing that's been successful for him is that people just want to help him out. They just want to make a good game.
Stig just keeps pushing along. He's got 2 brand new twins at home, and
yeah, it just keeps on
he's
going.
Got this other baby, this big baby on his back right now, so he's doing great.
Since last Halloween, made a lot of progress. Got the story of the game done. We got the whole design direction completed. 3 months from now, you know, we're going to be doing our press event.
Everyone gets to go home early!
The first couple times when Stig addressed the team, it was so clear how nervous he was. He would kind of stumble on his words, and he'd literally, you know, turn red, you know, like a stoplight. It was really kind of endearing. But then to watch him sort of evolve, and honestly, I think I was a little bit concerned that, you know, our game director is our public face. And we actually gave him, you know, some media training. And Stig actually asking people, he says, you know, honestly, I don't want to think about all this stuff. I just want to be myself. Is that okay? And they said, you know what? Absolutely.
That looks good.
Oh, wow. So that's how tall Kratos is. He's probably closer to the size of this guy.
Will is our stand-in Kratos when Kratos isn't here.
I'm about as close as you can get.
We picked the venue and the location for the spot, and we brought all the media here. We have something like 16 people here from the media. I can't wait for them to see the actual gameplay. But these guys are going to be thrilled.
Love Kratos. Kratos is hot.
be nice to see if he ends up a god or destroying Olympus.
I do love the violence as well. You know, the women are very beautiful in the game as well. I can't wait to see what new characters they've brought to us, what new enemies, and I'm really excited.
I also want the sizzle, you know? Maybe we can just focus it in a little bit more. We can play with that a little bit.
Yeah. The development team has worked so hard on this project, so it's really fun to see when all their hard work comes to fruition.
I'm going to get through the first couple slides up here, and then I'm going to start to walk around. Nobody has seen the gameplay outside of our studio, so this is going to be the first time. I want to get this over with. I'm nervous, but I'm also excited about this. I think we've got something really cool to show. I'm looking forward to seeing people's reactions.
Can we play it?
This is our first big kind of press thing. There's definitely some nerves with that. Anxious, I'm definitely anxious. The best thing that could happen today is people think it's awesome. You know, it totally kicks ass. The worst thing that could happen today is that people just flat out think it sucks. I don't think that's gonna happen, but you never know with these media people. What is the vision for God of War 3? We want to define this generation with this game. We're going to take a close look at him. I'll talk about some of the features that we're using on him. Here he is. We've got blended normal maps on him right now, so you can see the realistic muscle flexing. I would imagine that we've got one of the most advanced systems for that in the industry right now. The battle's in full swing. The god Helios is in battle with a massive titan. And Kratos is going to launch into battle and start doing some damage on the grunts here. Now, Todd can easily just grab one of the grunts by pressing circle. And if he continues pressing circle, he can beat the crap out of him. But if he presses triangle, then he can rip him apart. If he presses X, then he can throw him. And one more move, square, uses it as a battering ram. And then he can take it, mash circle, smash his head against the wall. And all these moves are interchangeable. Meet our latest AI, the Chimera. Part snake, part goat, part lion. Todd has just unleashed the Cestus on him, and you can see it's a brawling weapon. Now, the way the Chimera works is it's a three-stage enemy. First, you fight the snake stage, and then it changes its stance, and you fight the lion stage. We're really having fun with gore on this game. Entering the Cyclops. Every action that the Cyclops makes is a direct reaction from the pain that Kratos is inflicting on him. Well, that's our newest upgrade, the Helios head. It can be used to reveal secrets. Todd has now found the door of Eos. Another thing the Helios head can be used as is a lantern in darkened areas. This is our newest form of travel in God of War, Icarus Ascension. Todd now has full flight controls over Kratos and basically dodging gameplay. That's it.
Oh my God, it's fantastic. It was great.
It was phenomenal. I mean, like, I thought that I had a concept of what it would be like, but this pretty much blew everything completely out of the water.
We're putting a lot into this game. I said I think this game needs to be a defining game for this generation, and I truly believe it will be. I can't comment on what the future holds for the series because, you know, I'm focused on God of War 3 right now, but this is, God of War is, this is it. This is the end of the story. We got a lot of work to do, so there's no time for relaxing, that's for sure. E3 is obviously a big thing. We got to get this playable to the public, what we just showed on the demo here. We're in pretty good shape for that, but we got to get the game done. We still got a lot of work left to do. For E3, pretty nervous about it. Nervous, I mean, think nervous isn't a bad thing. You know, you should be nervous. Your nerves should be on edge, or else you're not going to get the thing done right.
It's kind of ironic that most people would have been happy with the reaction for the press demo, and we were kind of like, We could have done better. We've undertaken to basically change the rendering path between February and E3 to make it look much prettier and much more next gen. We have this amazing capacity to never know when to stop. Hopefully it'll all come together. I think it will. It's looking very nice. We definitely know how to pressure ourselves.
This team sets the bar really high. We could settle for a lot less and probably be a lot closer to being done, but with this group, they're
That'd
never
be
satisfied.
Too easy.
Yeah. We never do things the easy way.
Personally, I'm worried, but then I think it's good that I'm worried because that forces me to actually get this shit done.
Good. There's definitely pressure, self-created pressure, and then pressure from other departments just to get everything done. We're all just trying to do our best.
I think the most pressure we get is from ourselves. Every team is always looking at the other team's work and commenting and critiquing. Yes. So we're really pushing each other the most, I think.
It's a lot of back and forth.
The following week, it's absolutely nothing moves because we're going to need to take every freaking second to make sure it's stable and we are at frame rate. So, stay with that. You want to just...
The dead soldiers on the ground aren't in the poses?
Nope, and they don't have blood streaks and stuff in here.
Tyler is doing blood streaks.
All right, so we need a book over here then. The inactive mode would look like kind of like it does right now with the book shut. The active mode, the book would open up and we have to look like a glow around it.
We have to open and close the book.
Yeah, there's a book for it.
I wish I would have known that when we built it because we didn't build it to open and close.
Wait, you need the book to open and close?
Yeah.
There's no limit to good ideas, but there is a limit to how many of those good ideas that you can actually implement. And even if you make decisions and you make progress on things, it doesn't mean that you can get all those things done. We need to be able to tell people this thing is active now.
Can we remove it for E3?
Are you serious?
No, I'm not. I mean, there's a lot of other shit here to get done besides getting a book to have in an active states.
Let's say we don't do the open and close for E3. It would just have a glow effect and a light that comes with it, and
so
that's it.
Do we just put a sparkle on it then?
Absolutely have any compromise for the schedule right now. I have to trust production, and I have to trust the fact that they're telling me that we can't get things done. So I feel like there's little things that have been compromised. I don't know that the player's gonna necessarily miss them, but I sure am. It's part of making games. You don't always get what you want.
This seems like harder than the last time I played it.
We have to keep in mind that somebody from the street is gonna be playing with those harpies. And I don't know, the way it looks right now, on three tries, people will throw down the controller.
The stuff we just went through, pretty rough. It's a little frustrating from the respect that it's been kind of at this state for a long time now. Kind of wondering when it's gonna get fixed. The struggle or the challenge.
If it doesn't get fixed this week, we're screwed.
This is sprint week, meaning we're making a big push this week to get a lot of work done and make some headway going into E3.
As far as crunch goes, we're not going to call it crunch anymore. We're going to call it a sprint, and then everything will be fine. So as long as we do
change
that.
Change the name, it'll all be fine.
Tonight's the first night of...
crunch.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
We don't like the euphemism, yeah, sprint.
Fuck. I hate crunch. It sucks.
Right now, I'm creating a new build, and hopefully that will enable the rest of the studio to then continue working on the awesome content that they're creating for E3. They're definitely waiting on me. Definitely.
As far as my end, I feel I'm okay, but then at the same time, I kind of feel like I'm waiting on technology a little bit to kind of come online.
We just have a ton of bugs to fix. We're getting new technology right now, and the lighting's kind of broken, fog's kind of broken, so we're just trying to kind of survive, fix all our bugs, and get all of our tech in place so we can get this thing done.
You're sprinting now. Yeah.
Tonight's the first time the team has worked together as one, and there's a certain kind of level of excitement that goes into it and dread because we're still working, but it's a fun group to be with and we're trying to get stuff done.
You know, we can only do so much, right? And we'll just try to do as much as possible, as quickly as possible, and that's it. Hopefully we end up with something pretty cool though.
This is the biggest E3 we'll ever have.
Everybody wants to still see if Santa Monica still has it.
Oh,
Last 2 weeks have been very, very intense. I actually got here this morning, a half hour before the Shrine actually opened, to deliver live code for what we're playing this morning. I didn't have that code until yesterday afternoon.
The Sony press conference is their big moment. You know, 2 hours to like show all the new stuff they have. And it's gonna be broadcast on live TV and web. And we're gonna end the show with God of War 3. Anytime that you go first or last, if you open the show or close the show, it's an honor.
I guess we're happy that Sony seems so committed to our game. It's nice that all of our hard work over the last 7 years, really, because that's how long we've been working on the God of War series in total, is really getting the reception that it seems to be getting.
We're real excited that we're closing the press conference. It's a great opportunity, it's a great way to end. We're gonna be live on stage playing real live code, so nerves are definitely high.
Like a lot of jitters.
Stig's gonna be talking and I'm gonna be playing on stage, so a little stressful. Gotta take the edge off a little bit. Headlining scares the shit out of me. You know, I've never done something this big, you know, standing in front of 2,000 people or however many it is.
This is one of the most eagerly anticipated games of this generation. I'd like to invite Stig Askison to the stage to show you the first few minutes of the jaw-dropping God of War 3.
We at Sony Santa Monica Studios are excited to be able to present this live demo of God of War 3. God of War 3 is the final chapter in our fantasy trilogy based on the dark side of Greek mythology. Now our design director, Todd Pappy, will take point on the controls and we'll get into our demo.
I'm really anxious, I'm really excited. This is a really important moment for the team. It's important for the game. I hope that we make the impression that we always strive for. How it could have gone any better.
Well, I'm kind of glad that E3 is back. It's pretty exciting. It's been a couple of years since there was a really decent-sized E3. It's always exciting to have your game here.
This is what we work for. E3 is like Christmas.
We've got 12 kiosks set up with God of War. We had a great time last night setting it up. It was actually, we got there. The Sony booth was relatively quiet. All the games were up and running, but there weren't a lot of people playing anything. We started loading in the God of War, and people started lining up behind me to play it. I had somebody tell me today, one of the producers of another product told me, when we got in there and loaded our code, all work stopped at the Sony booth, so they'd come play our product. Hugely flattering. Big kudos to the team. Got chills just having that whole experience. It was awesome.
It was excellent. It was, you know, disgusting and exciting all at the same time.
I waited an hour to play in that game. Then when you finally get to decapitate Halo's head, that was like amazing. Didn't expect to see that.
It's pretty brutal. I mean, way more brutal than like the first two. Every new game, they bump it up a little bit, so it's definitely good stuff. Wait in line 2 hours to play. What can I say? It's God of War with unforgiving amounts of violence, great gameplay, kind of thing that, you know, just spend all day playing, not call your girlfriend, whatever, who cares, right?
I'm super, super pumped to see it. Yeah. I'm so jazzed, so. That's this true. Is Christmas.
This is Christmas.
But it lasts 3 days.
We can't believe it's back, you know? It's like awesome. Really good.
I'm so fucking happy that E3's back. I mean, it means so much for the industry.
Seeing people's faces when they play, we just ship it out to the store so the team really doesn't see, you know, people's reactions and just even the oohs and the ahs at the press event. Makes it all worth it.
Just seeing like the people's faces, I mean, that's why I make the thing, you know? I want to take people to that next level.
I think this is what excites the team the most, when they get to see people's reactions. We work our asses off before this to just get the demo to be as polished as possible, and you know, finished product when we're not done with the game yet. So by the end of this, we're so drained, we put so much energy into it, that all this energy coming from the outside just builds us back up and gives us that ability to finish the game.
E3s was a huge milestone for us. A lot of publicity, a lot of great feedback and great exposure.
E3 was awesome. I have to say it went very well.
Seeing all the fans and watching everybody play totally put us in a different mindset coming back from that. You really get locked up and don't really see people's reactions working on something for so long, and going and seeing people line up for your game, that's more than you could ever want, you know? It just kind of invigorates the whole team into coming back and working on something and wanting to put your heart into it and making it even better.
I think we did a good job with it at E3. And that shouldn't be our high point. That should be like our midpoint.
Alpha is when the whole game from start to finish needs to be in one bag. It can have placeholder assets, but you can fly basically through the whole game or walk through the whole game, and everything's represented in approximately the way that it will ship with.
Yeah, so ideally by alpha, we shouldn't go, oh, hey, we need that extra bad guy, or hey, we're gonna add a new boss.
Done on other games, so.
But ideally on God of War 3, you know, alpha will be, okay, all of our pieces are in.
And then after alpha becomes beta, and beta is basically art lock.
I want to make sure that when I'm playing the game, I've got a smile on my face. You know, I've played God of War for the last 6 or 7 years of my life now. As long as I've got a smile on my face, I think there's a good chance that that's going to translate over to the fans.
If you kind of take a look at this here, you can see this character that's the size of the Sears Tower, roughly. It's about 1,500 feet tall. It's a different kind of boss battle. Kronos is more than Gaia, is more fully alive, and you're more fighting on a character that's moving around. So this has been very tedious and challenging and time-consuming to put this together, but I think at the end it'll be definitely be worth it, and people will feel like they're playing something they never played before. Kronos will actually like thrust his hands forward into his scrape and leave his fingers there, so that you can actually attack his fingernails. We'll have a breakable on the fingernail, and then the fingernail will bring up like a circle prompt. You'll grab onto that and in the CS move, and then basically do a struggle and then rip it out, and you know, it'll be kind of a gory, cool, memorable moment. We actually want to make this awesome. We want to make this gameplay super exciting. It's going to be everything people expect from what the Titan fight should be.
What are the big tech issues, Chris, that you need support on?
It's the only big tech issue we need support on at the moment is the issue with the collision.
The more static you can get him, the more precision you will get in your CS move.
The problem is that since it's a skin collision, the skin itself is not just a non-deformable object that you can rely on to not have change from one trim to the other. That's the biggest issue we can have.
What we're doing hasn't really ever been done before, and so a lot of what we're running into are issues with trying to make it as exciting as possible, but working within the technical constraints that we have and in the time frame that we have.
I would say that the rewrite of skinned collision is turning into a very unrealistic proposition to get it finished before alpha.
Time is the biggest fun killer, usually, as far as developing. It's we come up with the most exciting scenarios, but do we have the time to put it together?
Fabrice and I will need to take a look at what is going on and what's fixable and what is not and what we'll have to design around.
With Kronos, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, and when you see it all together in the finished product with all the polish, I think it's going to be one of the most memorable experiences in gaming history. That's how I feel about it. I know it's going to be like that.
The murderer of Gaia enters my tomb, Kronos! I know it was you who killed her, Spartan. Who else could?
About a month back, maybe 6 weeks back after Alpha, we were looking at the end of the game and we felt like there was a lot of fighting and it didn't really tie into the story. We had a couple brainstorming meetings and we came up with this idea that it would be really cool to go inside Kratos' head, because that's where the struggle is really taking place. The story's really never done until the game ships, and we're always tweaking it, modifying it, but I really like working on the story. Kratos is going to have this emotional struggle inside of his head. And, you know, really the object of this game is he has to realize that he has hope inside of him, the power of hope. And that's what he originally got when he opened up Pandora's box. He didn't get the evil things, he got the good things. And I think it's going to be really, really fitting end to the trilogy. Keep in mind, you know, we're very close to beta here, and this is the big stretch. We really, really, really got to be zipping things up. Let's do it. That's all I got. That's all I got.
This is the third Halloween, I think, for many. It's probably a big relief. We're less than 3 months away from being done. It's been 2+ years. It's been an incredible journey. We've overcome so many pitfalls along the way with chains of personnel, project redesigns. Despite all that, we've managed to continue to elevate and continue to push ourselves and continue to make the best products we as a team can do. And I think God of War 3 is living up to that.
To complete the third one's pretty amazing. We always tried to hit the highest mark we possibly could, and I think we've done it once again with this one. So we're gonna have to wait and see what the fans think, but I have really, really high hopes.
Completing a trilogy is something I never did in my life, you know, and completing something like this is very special, you know, something that means a lot to me.
Sentimental moment.
This is truly one of the best teams I've ever worked with. I mean, across the board. I've worked with teams that were really strong on the art side, or really strong on design, or really strong on technology, but this is the only team I worked with that fires on all cylinders.
The team faced a lot of challenges. The interesting thing is that this team has always faced challenges, and it sounds kind of cliche, but they're really good at facing challenges.
Yeah, I agree 100%.
You know,
I mean, we've discussed a lot. Obviously, we've gone through a lot of different changes, and the team always, I mean, you
they can step
put
up.
It any better, but they always rise to the challenge.
We really sat down and like focused what we wanted to, you know, make good, and whatever wasn't working, we just kind of threw out the door and said, this is what we want, and that's what everybody focused on and made good.
Fans are going to be blown away.
We're still getting surprised as far as how good things look.
The game's awesome. It's going to be good.
I've been working with Kratos almost 7 years. I've learned a lot. He's taught me a lot. We've had some good times, but it's time for him to go to bed for a little while.
Here at Leo's desk, and we just, you know,
You want to say hi, Leo?
Hi, everybody.
So tell us about the pink ball. Is that something that you decided to put in, that pink spiky ball, or was just...
Well, yeah, I just decided to kind of create pink yo-yo.
One cool thing about this character also is that he's actually kind of like a throwback character. We're bringing him back from God of War 1. He actually wasn't in God of War 2. Because we definitely want to keep reminding the player that this is a trilogy. It's like, it's not, they're not supposed to be seen as separate games. So what about animating Kratos? Like, what are some of the things that are kind of challenging?
He has a specific poses that describing him. He has a kind of like a language of poses. You have to use those poses to invent some new animation, so.
We're fortunate to have Leo here because he's joining us for God of War 3. He actually is a new member, one of the newest members of the team. So he's doing a great job. And
One of the factors of animation is that you're kind of trying to make it invisible. The more successful we are, the less you really notice the animation.
The stuff we've got going on with our boss fights is going to look really impressive. It's another kind of key development for this game, I think.
We're working a lot with the designers, like way more closely, and creating new things with them.
There's a certain type of feeling that in animation we have to achieve. And the most important part, of course, is Kratos and how he moves. Kratos is very direct. We don't try to make him too fancy. If you notice, a lot of times when he's having conversations, he's just kind of standing there waiting for the moment where he needs to say something.
Everything that Kratos does happens for a reason. I don't know if many people even notice these things, but Kratos never moves backwards. He's an aggressive character. He moves with a purpose at all times.
We actually have wooden swords laying around all the time. We definitely get up and try to act it out. It's definitely always hazardous to walk around the animation area. You gotta watch out.
What are the challenges of animating something that big?
Planning out where everything needs to be. Like, nothing happens on accident. You need to know where everything is. I did not know that it was gonna be this big. I just had an idea and I was like, yeah, I'm just gonna go with it, which is kind of a bad idea. I learned my lesson. At the same time, I'm glad that it's the size that it is. The players will be happy that it's in there. I think they'll get an adrenaline rush just from seeing the sequence.
Kratos, your death will not be a gentle one. Ah! My eyes!
Camera design is the layout of cameras for the player's point of view in the game. So, and what we do is we basically control that player's point of view throughout the experience.
Cameras start with the design sheet being delivered to us by the level designer. That's the most basic form. We put in all the cameras for the design sheet. Once the cameras are in and it's been play tested and it proves that this is a good concept and we go forward with it, it gets sent off to the art department.
That's where they'll take it and they'll spend months sometimes making these areas look really epic. And then they'll get finished with it and then they'll hand it back to us. And a lot of times it's a little bit different, so we'll have to adjust some cameras. So
once the art comes back in and someone's spent a year building that level, they can be very touchy if they spent a year styling in this formation and my camera just goes right past it. We try to do our best to show off everyone's hard work.
And a lot of times there's a lot of cool things that you want to see in there that you can't see, so we'll go back and try to include those pieces in the shot that you get when you're playing the game. And from there, we play test it. This time externally, we get some people from the outside come in, take a look at what we're doing, making sure that that's great. After we get their feedback, implement their feedback, we're ready to go to the next area.
Anything we can do to make the cameras feel cinematic.
And they serve as a guide for the player to lead them in the direction that they need to go as well.
Yeah, whether they know it or not.
Yeah.
It's sort of like people who play the God of War franchise, after a while they get a feel that if the camera's looking this way, that's important.
In the very end, it always comes back down to what would the player want to see?
Most games in the action genre The player gets most of the control over the camera. Mm-hmm. Player has no control over the camera in the God of War series.
Fans have been clamoring, and I hear you. We need to look around. We want to look around.
It should be understood that there's really no way we could make the levels look this good if the player could look anywhere they wanted.
What we're trying to do, though, this time around, is give you key points where you're in the adventure and you can control the camera. So maybe you're in a crazy puzzle room and you need to be able to kind of look around. So in some of these areas, we can give the player control, but in a limited fashion. I hope the fans will appreciate that we're trying to implement their feedback.
What new feature do you like the best from the camera system?
The rail-driven cameras. I think that's been my favorite new feature as far as the technology that we have with the camera.
What's a rail-driven camera for someone who wouldn't know?
A camera that's animated along a course that we have even more control over what the camera is showing.
The rail is essentially what we kind of live and die by. Let's say this is your camera rail, this line here. And let's say this is the thing that's driving the camera. And imagine this is a section of a hallway or something like that that Kratos is moving along. We can take this camera here and we can key it. So we key to two different positions. So Kratos is here, the camera is here. When he starts to move along, as Kratos moves along, it will drive the animation of the camera to animate to that position. So as you're cruising along, you'll kind of see it, this kind of view where it's low and looking up at him. And then as he moves along, it will kind of track him and follow him. That's like one of our cool new things that we have that we think we can add a lot of kind of cinematic views to the game.
This is a perfect example of combat cameras right here. Here we're in a room, there's nobody to fight yet. And we can see we're taking a lower angle here. And as we come here, we'll trigger the spawning of a bunch of guys, and you can see the camera is gonna lift up so we can show more of the action. And the framing, we're gonna fit Kratos more towards the middle so you can see what's happening in front of him and see what's happening behind him. Try to give you the best view as possible for all the different combat actions that you're gonna be taking.
So this is an untextured view of the Olympus base. This is what the artist put together first before he assigned any lighting or textures to it. Well, you can see these green boxes. These are the camera zones. They determine when Kratos is within one of those boxes, and once he is, the specific camera tied to that box gets activated. This is what a level would look like after we've added our cameras. You've got it panning around, following Kratos. If you were to take that off, it would basically look something like this. Very basic, not much excitement. You can't really tell where the player's supposed to be going. Adding the cameras is part of what definitely helps the level design flow. Here's a good example of some lead space. We're trying to tell the player, this is where you want to go. Jump to this block over here. Once he's done the proper move, we zoom in, get him prepped for this nice shot of him making the leap. And then we transfer to another camera that shows him where you want to jump next, which is from here all the way down to there. So, and then he makes that jump. This would be an example of one of the vista shots we try to do in the game, which is you've got some really amazing piece of scenery in the background that the artists spend a lot of time building. So we want to get that into frame.
Character modeling is taking the art from visual development and turning it into a 3D model, painting it, giving it life, and then handing it off to our character riggers who send it off to animation. So we actually create the object itself.
It's in general just become, I guess you'd say, more sophisticated, but it's more of a traditional media now. It's kind of, if you know how to sculpt traditionally, then you're going to transfer right in. Traditional skills are playing a more important role, which is great.
Do you feel that you've channeling the great masters of art history to help you achieve
a new level? Raphael, you know, they speak to me.
Really? One of the big things that I was looking forward to doing is nasty stuff like this, because
Before this, I had been doing more technical stuff, more like realistic humans. Doing realism is fun to a certain extent. It's more fun to do something that's slightly realistic, because there's more artistic license as far as where you can go with it. With realism, there is no artistic license.
Creature design is kind of the most exciting thing. Like Peter was saying, artistic freedom, and just you can do kind of whatever you want, and you push things. I mean, that's what the Great Masters did, so it's just exciting to work on that kind of thing.
Here's my workstation. I have my Cintiq, which is what we use to paint and model. This is the monitor that we can actually draw on, paint on the screen, sculpt in ZBrush, which is very helpful and amazing. And then on the left of me, I have my standard monitor where I usually keep my reference. We're able to give metal a kind of specularity that we couldn't before. Scratches, blood, a real shine and realism that we couldn't deliver on the last project. We are working with a lot more polygons and a lot more textures on our project this time, per object.
Here's Hermes, the concept art that I got from Andy Park, who did a great job. You can see the boots are in there and what color they're supposed to be, what material. We're still working on the cloth, making sure that's all rigged nicely. And right now, I'm fighting with the hair, trying to make the hair look good. So hopefully by the time you see this in the game, it'll be looking nice and transparent. So here we are starting him out in ZBrush and adding a lot of the little detail. Say if you wanted his skin to bulge around these straps, it would be really easy to go ahead and just add musculature in here.
Today you may defeat me, but in the end, Kratos, you'll betray only yourself.
This is the Centaur in our game. Andy Park did the concept. They always do like a color version first, like this, to kind of nail the feel of the character and like what he's all about. And then they'll give us these turnarounds like this one. We have, you know, the horses have these like chest muscles that kind of flow up into the horse neck, you know, this way. And we have abdomen muscles and these obliques that kind of flow in. And where our hips sit, you know, is kind of where their shoulder blades sit. So typically most people draw centaurs. You know, I'm not the first one to make one of these things. So, you know, this has been thought about before. But typically, you know, our hips, like where the hips would sit on a human, they put where the shoulder blades would be. It feels kind of like it would work, you know.
Kratos was created from scratch simply because we weren't sure where we wanted to go in the third game, if we were going to change him at all, or if we were going to maintain the PS2 silhouette and essentially the same exact character. We felt like it might be an opportunity to really make some changes to him, considering the level of fidelity and sophistication in what we could create now on the PS3. We started out way out there. 2.5 years later, we decided that he looks like the PS2 model. So we're back to where we started, but it's really coming together, and it's right for the game. Kratos is a very heroic, very stylized silhouette, a very thin waist, very broad shoulders. He has kind of a swimmer's build on steroids. He's 8.5 feet tall, and he has a head the size of a 4-foot tall person. His waist is probably thinner than all of our wives. He's a trippy looking guy, but he reads really well in the game. Basically what I'm working on now is we've got an upper body and a mesh that the art director, as well as the director, really like. So now it's a matter of creating a blend map, which is new technology for Sony Santa Monica, in that we can do expressions. Basically, I'm just creating the rage, sculpting him, looking angry, and we'll be able to blend this new facial expression into the current model. So we can go from here to here. The satisfaction comes in seeing him in the game saying, wow, that's him. Only look, you can see his veins and you can see him breathing. And it looks better than the cinematics. That's kind of that's the satisfaction.
I bring the destruction of Olympus!
Caden's crow in the opening cinematic flies down and ends up landing on this hapless victim. And as he's eating the guy, he rips the eyeball out of the socket. So it's especially like juicy and nasty. Later today, I'll be working on the vein that the eyeball's attached to. So maybe the crow can like wrestle the eye out and really get some good squirming going on in the audience sort of thing. The way it works is that you lay down your base color. For example, with this guy, you get like a good skin tone going. And then from there, you add additional details. Like with this guy, his main details are the cuts that he has and then the dirt that's added. There's some sort of distortion going on here, and that's because it's actually being wrapped in 3D. So you can sort of feel where the chin line is just because of how these are bending.
This is Hercules, and he's wearing these cestuses, and basically they're like these huge gauntlets. Just trying to get across the fact that he's kind of like this aged warlord. He's not a super fresh young guy, so he's got some fat to him and some history. He's basically Kratos' brother, so a lot of the visual elements that he has, I think, parallel what Kratos wears. The really fun stuff was sculpting his flesh and his muscles and whatnot. Like, this is a final concept image, but we take it a step further and put a level of polish on it that isn't there. Because once it's here, this is a beautiful painting, but once it goes in the game, it needs to be perfect at every angle. Every angle you look at it, it has to be a great piece of work. So it's, you have to go in and you take this and you take everything a step further. And, you know, there can't be any mistakes.
Call it my 13th and final labor. Soon I will become the god of war and claim the throne for myself.
The role of a combat designer on God of War 3 is a complex role. Basically has anything to do with characters in the game. Any character you see moving in the game, attacking, fighting, are generally implemented by the combat designer. And then, of course, Kratos. What his platforming elements are going to be, what his new combat moves are going to be, what weapons he's going to use, how he's going to use them, how he walks, everything. I'm here with Jason McDonald, who's a senior combat designer on God of War 3. And we're just talking about the new features that we have in the game and what we're trying to add to the God of War franchise.
Well, we've got some of Kratos' items in. He can grab a head and he can light stuff up. Now that we can play with lighting in God of War 3, we can make the entire room dark, have enemies that are attacking you in the dark, can't be seen. And when you light them up with the head, they light up for a limited amount of time, so you can attack them while you can see them, but then they are constantly disappearing.
You get to parts where it's completely pitch dark and you hear the guys scream in the background. You use the Helios head to, you know, find out where they are. The strategy gameplay, the combat side of it, turns into you have to keep these guys lit to be able to hit them, otherwise you get screwed and they just destroy you in the dark. So
definitely something we couldn't do before just because we didn't have dynamic lighting to the extent that we have it now, so.
We got the combat grapple in.
We tried the grapple stuff in God of War 2, but since we were limited on memory and animations and things like that, we just couldn't do it. And if we couldn't do it well, then we weren't going to do it at all, so we just didn't do it. But now we have more space, more memory. Kratos is a very strong character, so when he grapples an enemy, he kind of just charges right in and plows through everybody. So the grapple system is exactly like that. You can launch somebody in the air and you grapple them and you ply yourself right into the air, right into them. If there's a crowd of enemies, you'll ply yourself through all of them.
Hey, I'm at Brian Yu's desk here. He's a senior combat designer on God of War 3.
For this particular boss, which is a huge scorpion, you want to make sure the presence is there and the player will feel the power of the attack. Usually for attacks for boss character, you want them to be really recognizable so the player knows it's coming, because if the player cannot recognize the move and, you know, react in time, they get hit, you know, because it's boss character, you will take a lot of damage. So it's not fun, you know, if you don't see the attack coming, you're being hit. So that's something that we try to work really hard on.
I'm here with Jason DeHaris, combat designer on God of War 3. And we're just looking over some of the writable stuff that's early in development. So how do you think it's going?
It's all right. In terms of Kratos, he still wants to kill this beast that's in his way to his ultimate goal. So it's not really his friend, so he's not really telling it to attack. He's just trying to kill it, and then the indirectness of that is the Cyclops reacting to his pain, pretty much. But then there's a challenge of making it feel responsive as well. So I guess it's kind of disguising that responsiveness with the pain reaction. So even the pain reaction is really a hit, actually.
As you can see, we got a bunch of grunts on screen right now. And when you're fighting all these grunts, like taking on, you know, doing a special move or, you know, grabbing each one and killing them, that can be kind of slow. This will be an awesome tool for, like, you see the Cyclops in there, and you're just like, I want to get after the Cyclops so I can jump on his back and do tons of damage and kill these guys quicker. But just like any other feature, you know, We have to prove that it's going to be fun and good. And, if it's not, we got to get rid of it because everything has to be fun.
We're starting to do an environment, we'll receive a concept from our concept artist. And they do this elaborate, crazy drawing that looks really cool. And then from that, design already has their design laid out. It's basically like a sheet. You just bunch of blocks and boxes that already, gameplay's already in there, it already works. From there, we go over it and we start building our level with it. You know, we layer on geometry, the hills, mountains, whatever's gonna be in there, and incorporate all that into the sheet so it all plays together nice and make it look pretty.
Every corner in the game is pretty much unique. It's handcrafted, and that's the difference. You look at other games, it's an assembly line, it's mass-produced. They'll build a crate, and then you'll see that exact crate hundreds of times throughout the game. You don't get that in God of War.
Good people here. Everybody's really talented, super talented, but nobody has an ego or anything like that, so it's great. Cool.
So what's gratifying for me is coming in every day and actually liking the job that I'm doing. You know, I bore my girlfriend with, you know, how I'm gonna, you know, make this sweet piece of metal like even sweeter. I enjoy talking about it, she hates it.
Biggest challenge is getting it done on time.
You lose sense of what starts to look good to you and you actually need other people's eyes to tell that. And I think working with a team of guys that are always open to giving you advice and telling you, hey, this looks great, or hey, maybe this could be worked on a little bit, really makes the art come out to look a lot better.
I'm gonna show you an example of how we do collision. So here's the basic level that we're working on right now. And then we have the stuff we call sheet, which is the real basic collision stuff that Kratos walks and runs on. So this is actually built by a designer. This gives us the basic places where he needs to run and defines kind of the gameplay spaces. And then we build our art over that. So what we then have to do at a later point in development is go in and make sure there's a cylinder around here and there's a cylinder around here, and that we make sure that we put in little divots into this collision so that he doesn't get stuck on things or walk through things. And then here, you can see where he is walking, there is collision. But if you look carefully right now, because the sheet isn't actually finished, his feet move through little places in the ground and things like that. And because like there's wall, we have collision right there, he can't go through this wall, but we don't actually have any collision on this pillar, so he's gonna go weep and walk right through. So eventually that's what we'll have to do, is make sure that all that stuff is in there and that he can't walk through these pillars. And that's what collision is.
This is concept by Cecil Kim, and it's the exterior of the top of Mount Olympus with the Zeus statue there. And that's where you're going to be fighting Zeus. And this is another piece that I asked Cecil to do for me. And it's a top down of the ground. That's when concept art really comes in handy, because we have to do so much ground that Kratos is transitioning over that it's really nice to get some fresh ideas. And I'll take his drawing here and then start fleshing it out and coming up with crazy marble and gold. And he had this cool feather idea. You get dirt and stuff picking in between the feathers, adding, I guess, an extra layer of filth to the world. You build it clean first, and then I'm gonna go in here and destroy it and make it look like a fresh battle has happened in it.
So here's an example of a piece in Tartarus. This is a gate that basically raises up on these chains from the side. This is a pretty detailed piece from what we would normally get from a concept artist. We'll get, you know, big vista shots, and then if it's an important piece, we'll get something like this to sort of detail out what it should look like. So this is what I'll get. My first step after that is to figure out these shapes in 3D. I'll create something like this. This is just a wireframe, you know, just like any video game. You know, nothing too special about it. If we bring this into a high poly modeling program to really add a lot of the detail and like the grit and the texture. So this works a lot like real clay. You can see how I can just sort of work over it and obviously not be that sloppy. But That allows me to get all this detailing and stuff in. Once we get it to that point, we end up getting all that high poly detail as a texture. And you can't really see it too well on here, but I brought it up on this screen. You can see how a lot of that high detail gets transferred on there. That's really kind of one of the big cornerstones of all this next gen stuff.
This is one of the Hades levels. You can see right here, it consists of a large room and then a series of halls, little torch things in there. This is pre-lit, this is just the polygons. In this game, we are pushing a lot of polygons. The environments are, at least this one is probably twice the size of a God of War 2 level in terms of polygons and probably four times larger in textures. If you look at the screen here, this is the level after it's been initially lit. You see we have a nice bloom going on now, which we just got. So you can see the softness that you have along all the lights. Before, lighting used to be really harsh. The bloom just gives it kind of this real world foggy effect. Just gives the scene a nice softness to it. Gives it kind of a cinema quality. Eventually his lighting will match the environments and it'll look really nice.
What I've been working on lately is building the environment for a movie trailer. So it's been a little different than building a regular environment. I've imported the camera and I scrub through what the camera's gonna see and I just make sure my environment fills in all the gaps. This is the base layer of what will ultimately be a pretty dense forest. This is constantly what I do. I'll just scrub through the animation, see where the camera goes, make sure I have enough detail in certain areas. If I don't have enough detail or if you see obvious seams, I'll either cover those up or I'll consider how fast the camera's actually flying through this and will it all be blurred out anyway and I won't worry about it. This scene is a little more detailed than a regular environment would be just because it is a rendered movie. So that's the end of this camera. And then it continues on.
This is the concept that we get, and basically this is an overall of the entire level. It's a big cave, and you have these rock pillars. You got your cave with the waterfalls. You know, it has little details in there, but it gives you the whole picture. You get your rocks, the greenery, the waterfalls, and then the architectural bridges.
This is basically the sheet that we get from the designers, and that's the basic layout that we start with. And from there, we start building the actual rock and geometry on top of the sheet. You have gameplay that you can go along with as you're building your levels to see exactly where the camera views are going to be and what you need to build out. Here's an example of where I start. I have all these rocks. This is going to be a whole rock level. You have a massive level on scale compared to any of the other ones we did in God of War 1 and God of War 2. And it's all very detailed rock geometry. It takes a long time to cut all this stuff in and make it look pretty.
Here we have the original concept art that was for the grate that I designed and modeled in 3D. So here in ZBrush, obviously, I added some rope detail. Whether it was a rope or not in the concept, it looked as close. I tried to get as close as possible, so I just assumed it would be a rope. So that's what I did here, and obviously we have some of the nails going inside. This is what it came out to be. We knew we wanted a different color than what we had in the original concept, so you notice the color is a little different. We could actually bring it up to the PS3, and we can take a view of what it would look like in game. So back here is like the original model, and then here is the detailed version of that.
This is one of the pieces of concept art for the Olympus hub at the top of Mount Olympus. I am in the process of arting it. You can see a lot of stuff is still just the gray blocking pieces, but starting to get some of the detail. Pretty much the way they have our tools set up, anything I build here, I can, within reason, quickly send it over to the development kit. I can send the entire level over so I can run around and play and interact with the environment. I can also take chunks of the environment, send them over just so I can kind of view a specific section that I'm working on. Still a lot of the gray areas I need to go in and fill in the details. You can see this down here, still all needs to be done. This is kind of our art sheet version, which kind of block in the basic shapes and spacing and everything. These things we put in a level, they're scale versions of Kratos that we use just to make sure we're keeping our scale correct when we're building the stuff so details don't get too out of whack.
To me, level design basically is creating an interactive narrative within each level that the player can engage in and essentially play through.
Level design is taking the story and premise of the game and then translating it into a more tangible form that the player can experience.
Basically kind of figuring out how to lay out the gameplay to always have the carrot dangling in front of the player's head and kind of get them to the next part. What do you think?
I think that sounded amazing.
The script is pretty well written out, so you get a really good written description of what's going on, like what Kratos is doing, what's happening in the story. You just kind of go from there.
I get a lot of flack because I say that we put the fun in the game, and I think that's really what we do in a nutshell.
One of the greatest things about game design is that you're able to take an idea that's in your head and make someone go and experience that.
We have so many tools in this universe and so many tools as far as what the game is built off of that we can pretty much do what we want. You know, we're limited by our imagination, and I think that's one of the most fantastic things about working on this project.
As a designer here at Sony, you can't just be good at one thing. It's really in our hands to do it all and do it well.
We often try to integrate the puzzles into the exploration of the level and with the combat. You're going to have a lot of games where all of a sudden you're in your fight mode, and once that's done, then you're in your puzzle mode, and it almost feels like you're playing two different games. One thing we try really hard to do here is to mesh those different kinds of game designs so we get a really more fluid and dynamic gameplay experience.
We essentially drive the vision of the level from the player's perspective and serving as the ambassador to them. So we need to protect their interests and make things easily understandable for them as they're playing through the level. Do you agree?
It's a constant push-pull as well with the designers and the artists, because the artists may want to put something that's visually more interesting in, but it could also impact the play space in a negative way.
I can't emphasize enough how important playtesting is to our process. If we didn't have it, the game would not be what it is. Because when the player takes the product home, we don't want them to be frustrated.
You learn so much just watching people play it. That's one of the most valuable things you could ever do, is just sit down, give the person the controller, and just watch them play, see what they do.
I think one of the strongest things that this team has, actually, is having, you know, the game director come in and play it, have members from all the disciplines sitting down, and because everybody, you know, chips in, hey, how are we gonna animate this? Animators are sitting in, how are we gonna build this? You know, world builders are sitting in. Is this even possible? Coders are sitting in. That process makes everything just improve immensely, and I truly, truly mean that. I think a lot of people will say that, but here, it's extremely, extremely, extremely noticeable.
And this is some ideas that I had for a grapple section, where basically Kratos would grapple onto a broken column, and that would cause it to fall over, and he would be rolling down the hill with it and climbing up. Kratos hits a grapple point, swings around this column, lands on the backside, which says it's a tilt over. It starts rolling down a hill, and he has to scurry up it using his climb. He gets on top and then jumps off to land on a platform before the thing rolls off a cliff. So that's kind of just some of the stuff that we think. And when we talk about big moments, this is some of the stuff that we deal with. I have no set process. I'll go from paper to computer to design sheet and then back to paper. It's really kind of organic. I love this idea. There was another version where we had a titan actually holding onto it and like eating as it's rolling down, like trying to bite you like it's a piece of corn. That unfortunately didn't make it into the game, but one of the things is just because I love an idea doesn't necessarily make it the best fit for the game, and being willing to understand that and walk away from certain things that don't necessarily fit, you know, that's part of the job.
This is my grandpa's old man puzzle. It's one of these kind of puzzles you gotta figure out how to kind of put it together, but this kind of gave me some inspiration for the labyrinth. So the labyrinth is like this level where there's all these different cubes and they're kind of like strung up throughout the cave entrance. And they're all like on these pulleys and ropes. And then as you go around the level, you kind of start slowly forming your own puzzle that you're gonna then go into. We came up with this idea for Gaia coming up to this rotunda where, you know, Zeus and Kratos are kind of having their last epic fight. And the player's thinking, you know, it's, you know, mano a mano, they're just gonna be battling, and then Gaia kind of comes into the picture and then ends up actually like physically ripping the whole building up and then like looking at it, and then you guys start fighting inside of it. She comes up and then like rips it off, and then she, you know, comes up and crushes it and takes it apart. At the end, you guys are like fighting inside of her and you end up killing her, and then she kind of blows up and crumbles all over Mount Olympus. For me, it's always like so amazing to be able to imagine this whole kind of crazy scenario, this whole world in your head, and then you're actually able to make it. Ah.
I've been working on the Aphrodite Chamber, which is where one of the infamous lovemaking mini-games will be taking place within the larger game. This is the preliminary room that I brought up in Maya. Roughly what's going to be happening is Kratos is going to be going through a hallway here where he's going to come to this room. There's going to be a bed in the corner with curtains drawn. And as soon as he casts them open, he's going to see Aphrodite with two of her very lovely servant girls who quickly run away. She's going to go into the bed for a little hanky-panky. And we see the servants are very happy right there with what's going on. After finishing his job, Aphrodite is kind enough to draw back this large curtain, which will expose the portal, which will lead to another section of the game. So that's generally an idea of how we mock up an event relatively quickly so that we can assess how the gameplay will be, and then we can forward that off to art so that they can make it pretty. And this is some of the things that concept art has done. This is the bed right here that you saw. It looks a little more fancy than the blocks that I've been using. Once that's done, I will implement them into the game and everything will mesh together perfectly.
Be gone, Kratos.
San Diego this week, capturing mocap for cinematics. Stig Meddy and I came down here about 4 months ago just to tour the facilities. It's really impressive down here, actually. It's a big stage. They do full body mocap. They can do hands and faces down here, and they have a ton of crazy toys. It's amazing that we have this facility that Sony owns that is basically at our disposal, and the teams here are really great.
We're suiting up.
Getting her suited up for the day. Yeah. Velcro custom suit we get made specifically for motion capture. We have some colored panels on there just to accentuate the actors when they're out there, just to make sure that we can see exactly what's going on instead of having an all black suit with the all black floor. And
this is the Gumby suit.
I need a mocap.
Mocap is basically markers in space that are seen by cameras. They're calibrated to be able to be triangulated into a certain point in space.
It really serves as kind of a basis for us to layer animation on top of.
Got a little coffee. My shades on. This is how we do LA mocap.
Body twist, ankle and knee.
This is called the ROM, or the range of motion, where we show all of our flexibility and bendability of our body so that the computer can track our markers.
Gaia and Titans are going to be climbing up Mount Olympus, so this is our Mount Olympus right there.
Don't try this at home, kids.
As much as I've directed before was with my little sister and my little brother when we were kids and our parents had the video camera. But it's fun. I think if you know what to do and you can communicate with people honestly and you know what you want, they love it. And people are having fun if you are. Ariel, we're going to do the following now?
We're not necessarily as concerned with perfection in really subtle movements because we know that that subtle animation is going to be done by the animators in-house. As long as we can see the character there, then we're getting what we want.
This is the real-time feed of the actual character, of the motion capture being done. So you're actually seeing like a stick figure, but it's actually a skeletal figure of Richard, the actor being out there.
We don't see your feet in that shot, so it doesn't really matter where they are. And break your symmetry if you can, so both arms aren't exactly the same.
Rolling.
All right, thank you. That was good.
Yeah, what you're actually seeing here is the mocap actor actually driving the Gaia character in real time. So,
hear it down?
It's definitely amazing technology.
Take two, ready.
Rolling.
All right, good, thank you.
Eddie is doing well. He's been a great director. Definitely knows the shot he wants, and he gets it.
We sit at a desk all day, and I also like to move around. I think as a director, you should be able, to a certain degree, to do what your actors are doing. So you know what you're asking of them. You can show them if you have to. And I don't know, you get closer to their performance. Don't ever put that in the making of video.
This is actually a first for me to do motion capture on a bed with pillows. We're working on the
sex minigame.
The sex minigame with Aphrodite. So we'll have two of the girls today just doing both the parts of the servant girls and Aphrodite, which we have blocked out. So should be an interesting afternoon. If we have time tomorrow afternoon, maybe we'll put Mehdi in a suit because there are some things I'm sure.
If I'm gonna do that, I'd rather do it now to do the sex minigame with Ava and Michelle.
Well, I'm not directing it if you get in a suit, that's all I gotta say.
I'll direct from the bed.
Yeah.
I'll be Aphrodite, I'll be like, you touch me here, you put your leg there, yes. Let's do take 55. Ava? All right, let's do take one.
And rolling.
Kratos, it's been far too long. Even though you are no longer the god of war, you can still share my bed. Come, Kratos. Let us forget all about Zeus for a while.
You know I cannot.
Ah, is that what has you all worked up? You are trying to figure out that bridge contraption out there. Please do not deny me this one last pleasure.
That was great. Cut.
Ah. Is that what has you all worked up? You are trying to figure out that bridge contraption out there. You men and your toys.
Exactly. That's good.
I think for casting for this, Mehdi found people who were good with their body in terms of motion.
We picked actors that had to be comfortable.
The God of War 3 music production plan is pretty extensive. Today we're working at Skywalker Sound in Marin County. We're working with the San Francisco-based musicians from the San Francisco Symphony, the San Francisco Opera, who are phenomenal. We're really fortunate to be working with legendary engineer Leslie Ann Jones. Tim Davies has orchestrated everything and he's conducting from the podium.
That's pretty sweet.
He really knows the music, and he really puts his all into interpreting what the composers are after.
Really pointed. Give me that nice pop on the end of each group. Here it is. Beautiful. Thank you.
The music originally comes in from the composer in what we call a mock-up, which is basically he's using his synthesizers and samplers and, you know, we call them fake strings, fake brass, fake choir, to assemble the composition.
And then once it's approved, it comes to me to translate that and put it on paper for the orchestra. It's damn expensive to have an orchestra sitting there, so my job is to make sure that everything's spotless on the page in their language. when dealing with an orchestra as a conductor, I think 75% of it is your rapport and how you can interact with the musicians, getting them to do what you want in a highly stressful situation, making it lighthearted enough that no one freaks out, but you gotta keep it moving.
Give me everything you've got on those crescendos at the end of each phrase. Here it is.
They're a pack, and they need a leader, and they're all brilliant musicians, but there's something about when you put an orchestra together, they need that focal point, that one person that they follow.
These are pretty nasty swells where you got the flutters and everything. Feel free, if it's gonna be smoother, to hit the note and then start the flutter later. Okay, here we go.
They can smell when you walk into the room if you can do it and if they're gonna go with you. I've been lucky that, you know, they like me and I've been here a lot to the ranch to conduct. And, you know, it works really well and they're a great orchestra.
Originally on God of War 1, we had several composers, many of whom have remained with us through the God of War series. And the reason for this is not because one composer wouldn't necessarily be able to compose the whole score. It's because the variety that their different styles bring to the table is actually a tremendous advantage.
Why are there five composers on this collection?
Well, that's a question, for somebody else who did the hiring, because I'm sure that any one of us would be quite happy to bump the other ones off and do it all by ourselves.
And a different alternate to that answer is... the reason being is because each one of us actually have a very strong voice in how we write and approach music. But generally speaking, we don't clash in styles, and therefore what ends up happening is a happy salad of the different styles that we all bring to the game, but essentially we actually work very well together as a team.
Sitting with Stig and sitting with the whole Sony crew who have such, they have this thing in their minds called God of War. It's an entire world. It goes beyond just characters. It's a whole, they know how they want everybody, they want the players to feel. I think what ties my music and your music and everybody else's music in is the fact that the great people at Sony, from Stig and down, is they know when it's wrong and they know when it's right. And even though we haven't heard each other's music, it ties together amazingly just because it's run through this filter, and the filter is God of War.
Right.
One of the great things about scoring for video games as opposed to film is that there's a tremendous amount of freedom.
I'm not constrained whatsoever by any convention at all, because I think a video game is not a film. And since we're not restrained by anything that's happening at any particular point in time, it's quite a free world to actually envision what you want to write and see it through to the end.
The music actually is not only on a par with film, but in some ways surpasses most films. There's almost a requirement, certainly an expectation, that there be experimentation and innovation in video games, that the music is somehow striving to do something new and something really fresh and powerful, which isn't always the case in film.
When it comes to raw power, I mean, this actually goes to another level than most films.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we have to write music that must exist and take care of the atmosphere that you're in and add to the intensity of the battles that you're in. It's kind of carte blanche. We get to write these amazing sounding scores and have it backed by 40 plus piece string section, 20 plus piece brass sections. The sky's the limit.
We use a oversized brass section, so it's double the size of a normal standard orchestral brass section, just to give us this massive power and this huge low end. Guys that play low instruments, all they want to do is play low, and so we give them that opportunity.
You get to unleash and not hold back, because the game never holds back, never.
I talked to the orchestra and I said, if you have any moment that you have all of a sudden a feeling of lyrical beauty coming your way, ignore that completely and just go for the brutal, brutish, aggressive mentality of this score, and you'll never go wrong.
That's hugely fun. Yeah. And it's so much more fun to write bad music than to write, you know, good music.
This is one of those games that actually lets you go all the way to the end of how big could it be, how nasty could it be. And it's great to do that. Of course, at the end of it, you just want to do a romantic comedy with some clarinets and...
That was really good.
at least as composers, we're being hired to do what we do, which is write melodic material, aggressive, edgy material that people remember. Think about when we went to go see your favorite movie as a kid, and you walk out humming the theme, and you want to buy the soundtrack because it's such a great part of the experience, and that's what we're trying to do.
Is to get people to buy the soundtrack to Godzilla 3. Yeah, I forgot. Good point.
We did just go down to the studio, and we saw where the game's at, and the game, as you probably have just played through to unlock this video, is amazing.
I love brainstorming. Yeah. That's one of the best things about games. Right from the beginning, it's
just a creative process.
Yeah, it's fun.
What happened to the original concept art for Poseidon? No, the concept art for Titan, a water Titan.
Can we bring it up on here? That's fucking sweet. That's really fucking cool.
He's even got the tentacles.
Whatever we come up with, it's like, hey, that would be cool if we could, and we just make it form out of water, whatever it might be.
A lot of talented people were sitting in that room figuring out, oh, this would be cool, this would be neat, throwing out all these ideas out, doing our best to try and live up to the God of War 1 and 2 standards, which are
the bar's
insane.
Really high.
It's like, it has to be like, almost like in a shape that's like scary.
I agree with that. When you pull the camera out, what do you see? And if it's like, if it is like, he's turned into like a huge squid and and she's all tied up or something like that. But as you're like fucking flea size and as you're running around, you see a big part of this.
What do you think, about maybe that, whatever that thing is, it's a lot of different things?
It's everybody, you know, it's not just one person that comes to the table and has, okay, here's the perfect idea, it's everybody rifting together.
Just like the idea that Poseidon swells up with water and just becomes semi-translucent and you can see all of his veins and stuff. And so that way you're actually hitting flesh.
Going off of sort of like Will's idea and a combination of the things that we talked about is his skin is basically like a jellyfish. On the inside of his body, he has all the bones. He has actually a bone structure. That way we have a creature that, you know, looks like it has some meat to it made out of the ocean.
So I think like going off of what you were talking about, where it's like maybe you've got like reef and seaweed and stuff like that, we can even have, we could probably make it look like water's running through that stuff.
I would hope that we at least all kind of get on the same page. At the end of the day today, it's like, yeah, this is kind of somewhat direction we're gonna go.
Maybe it starts off and a wave crashes up, and after you see like this far shot or something of a wave kind of overtaking Kratos and Gaia on the side of the mountain or something like that, you're freaking out. I was like, you're probably freaking out right now because of the cinematics. But then afterwards, guys, like, something's fucked up right now, I can't move. And then Kratos has to go out and find out what that thing is, and he runs into this one thing. It's like, what the fuck is this thing? And it's obviously connected to something else. And then he finds the other thing later on. And at the end, there's this big reveal, and it's like, and this is what this whole thing was that you were fighting it the whole time. I think that's cool pacing, because there's always a question in the player's head while they're proceeding. It's like, I don't know what the fuck this thing is.
When they first approached me to work on Poseidon, they told me it's going to be the very first big boss fight. Poseidon, if you remember from God of War 2, he looks more like just like a human god form. But in this game, he jumps down from Olympus into the ocean, and then he emerges out as a big water creature. This is my first sketch I did for Poseidon after doing a bunch of research on exactly what Poseidon is, the god of the ocean, the god of horses. So I thought to incorporate this design of a creature, of him being made of water and the actual waves kind of looking like horses. And then this is another one along the same veins, having a lot of horses, so just kind of going wacky. Another sketch I did was this one where I incorporated multiple Poseidon's heads throughout the design, showing that he's in control of this water tentacle. They liked this design a lot with the multiple heads, and they also liked the very first sketch with him leading the horses. They liked this one the best, so they liked this for the overall direction. So they saw this, they liked the feel of this, but they didn't like the direction of the octopus limbs because of previous bosses that we've had, like the Kraken. So this is just one of the limbs of the Poseidon creature, one of the arms. This one I incorporated the multiple faces, and then a lot of the crab legs. And then this is another one I did. And this one I wanted to kind of bring back because he's a god of horses to kind of capture some of that feel. So eventually they decided that instead of having two different arms, you're gonna just be fighting one arm. And they also like the idea of the horse. This is the final, the very end. You're gonna be opening up his chest and revealing like this membrane, jellyfish kind of membrane, where you stab and eventually kill one of his limbs. It's later going to be revealed to you that you've been, the whole time you've been only fighting one of his limbs right here. It's going to be a really cool big moment in the game.
Turnarounds are looking pretty nice.
Today I'm going to be having an art review. We're getting to the completion of one of the Poseidon's limbs, so I'm working on the turnarounds now.
Get the animators up here and make sure that those limbs, the front limbs, are not too long for him. Like, he'd have to raise it up so high.
To get you right below, he'd have to be, like, basically have his arms way up like this and be going down like that, and that's probably going to look a little silly. Let's have Andy finish this up. But, Andy, can you save off a version of what you have right now so Adam can go over it with Bruno? And just keep on getting me up here to look at it. Cool. Thanks, man.
Thanks, guys. So we just had the review. It went well. They like the direction, and I think a lot of it, because before this is the view they've always seen, but they've never seen the front view. So for them to be able to see the front view and to see how the shape, the silhouette actually makes a trident shape, they really like that idea. I just have to finish this up. I'll probably finish it up today, and it'll be given to the modelers from there.
First time I heard about Poseidon creature was 6 months or so ago, and I heard we're gonna have a few of these huge Titan battles. This was the initial concept that was given to us. Things have changed proportionally for it to work right on screen, but it, you know, it generally has the same feel. I still have a lot of sculpting left on this guy. It's a lot of this is just like the first pass. So right now I have more just the overall feel of it. Here's Kratos. He's pretty small compared to this guy. So I brought him in here just so I could have an idea of how big he's gonna be. So when it comes to details, how high res this character has to be, so you can see him, he's tiny. I just want you guys to go over and check it out before I start making all the rocks for his face, you know? So.
Yeah, I think it's good. Can we make sure that we're getting like some of this smaller detail like spread out over him as well?
Okay.
Can I see the scales on the back?
Oh, yeah.
It's just really fucking cool.
Poseidon looks to be challenging for every department because it's so complicated. When I first saw the concept, really, I kind of looked at it and was like, what the hell are you guys doing? But that's pretty much what I say every time I see one of these crazy concepts anyway. You just go to your desk and beat your head against the table and figure out how the hell you're going to pull it off.
Poseidon definitely falls into that class of one of those kind of surprises that I know is coming down the pipe. a lot of water, and that's kind of one of my worries because making good water is hard.
We have to start off God of War 3 with a bang, and that's Poseidon. And Poseidon's gonna be a water creature, so we have to make water look good on that character. I started doing some research on how we can make a character feel as if he's basically a waterfall, if there's water running down him. And I spent a couple hours, and I've put together the model that's behind me on the screen here. We basically want to try to prove the technology that we can make a model look like it has water running down it. So we don't have the Poseidon model built yet, but we have Zeus. Poseidon is Zeus's brother. They'll probably have similar type proportions. So he was a good test. This is a shader that I put together. It's pretty crazy with all these different connections. There's several different neural maps that are scrolling on top of each other. This probably took me 3 hours to set up the shader on top of an existing model. So where I want to take this now is I'm going to give it to the effects department, and I want to see like chunkier spraying water kind of coming down off of him. And then basically any area where water hits the surface, we just want to get little particle spray coming off to, you know, just give this thing more of a volume, more water volume.
When I started on it, we had already established what Poseidon was going to look like, what the creatures that you're going to be fighting was going to look like, what Gaia was going to look like. We had the Gaia model. The Poseidon creature model was still in the process of being built. One of the quick things that's very surprising to the player, I guess, will be that right there is how big Kratos is. And That's Gaia. And this will be the initial fight combat tutorial. At that point, Gaia will change her animation and she'll start climbing on the mountain differently to allow the player to be able to walk down her arm. And the Poseidon intro will happen. The player will continue along after that. She'll be in a different pose. He'll walk over here, he'll do just a little jump, come down here, fight some more enemies, and then he'll walk up to here, and this is where the Poseidon horse creature encounter happens. So this is the first thing the player will see when he loads up the game. We're trying to frame her hand and show that she's climbing up Mount Olympus, which is just roughed out right here. And then we also want to find a way of getting her head in the shot and having her head bob around and sway. After the player works his way down Gaia, this will be the first big encounter that he experiences. The Poseidon creature will burst out, knock Gaia's hand back. He'll have to fight it. We're concerned with the player experiencing this new creature that he has no clue as to what it is. And the first thing he's doing is fighting it in a way that he doesn't feel comfortable. This is the first Poseidon creature encounter, and this right here is the first CS move kill for it, where he snaps its jaw. And at this point, the creature pulls away through Gaia's arm. Kratos attaches to him, and then as the creature's falling, he jumps off. He'll transition onto Mount Olympus.
The Poseidon encounter is very much like you're riding the Colossus from God of War 2, and you're fighting the Hydras on top of the Colossus. It's kind of incorporating all of those elements that worked really well in the previous God of Wars, but also raising the bar because it's even more epic than could ever withstand before. This is what I was delivered, the thing you encounter within 5 minutes of starting the game. This is essentially a rough version of the model. It's a pretty good start. It's got all the features like this stretchy tail, which is pretty cool. It even has stretchy neck, which lets me do some crazy stuff with it. Since this creature is supposed to be made essentially out of water, he needs to be fluid and flexible. Then he's got this trident section back here. He uses that to maybe discharge lightning at the player or, you know, do something very Poseidon-esque. This is the scene with Gaia and the tentacle creature and Kratos. And you may ask, where is Kratos? Well, he's in here somewhere. He's this little tiny dude right here. There's Kratos. I see him. So you can imagine trying to get the camera in here in the right place is kind of a challenging task. Plus, the floor is Gaia, and Gaia's moving around, so adds a lot of complexity just to the elements of trying to get everybody lined up. You encounter this beast multiple times, so you fight him first and you wound him and he retracts away and escapes, and then you come back and then he's on another point in Gaia. And then finally, you realize that wasn't even the monster, that was just a small piece of the monster. And you get up to Gaia's head and that's where you encounter the full force of Poseidon. This is the actual Poseidon creature. This is Gaia's head here you're standing on. This thing has 10 arms and legs, kind of, and then it's got 3 prongs on its back. It's also got well over 20 controls just in its spine. There's a lot of stuff going on.
He's busy, but that was my first initial impression, was there's a lot going on with Poseidon. The more I think about him, the more epic and grand, why not? I mean, that's kind of like a God of War boss will be, especially when you're dealing with pieces of him as you go through, and then when you come to the very end, being able to see the full glory of him and just realizing, wow, that's just a little piece of him here, and that's just a little piece of him here, and getting to the end and going, wow, he's huge. And that should be pretty epic, being little Kratos on Gaia, a Titan, versus Poseidon, a god, and they're both huge, and you're just this little guy in the middle of it that's really gonna change or determine who's gonna win that outcome.
Michael and I have been working on the Poseidon boss battle for a couple months now, and we've been working through the progression for the whole fight, working with Justin as well on the level design side. We're trying to get the whole layout so we have a bare-bones skeleton of how things progress. It goes back and forth to have an interesting pace to the beginning of the game. We're in the first encounter of the Poseidon boss fight. We've already seen the creature come out. Poseidon boss battle is definitely something we haven't done before. There is concern, but I wouldn't be happy if we weren't concerned. There's no challenge there. What we want to do is make something that really surprises people and really gets people excited about the game. This is the initial CS move, the first CS move you do in God of War 3. Kratos is going to wrap his chains around the bottom jaw of the Poseidon creature, and then eventually rip the jaw off completely.
It's better than over here, which was the initial placement.
Boob Valley.
I don't know if that little show reflects. When you're down here, it's kind of distracting.
Initially, we had Encounter 2. The creature was coming directly out of the center of Gaia. And you see two gigantic mountains and the creature right in the middle of Boob Valley. Everybody giggles when they saw that. So
that wasn't what we were going for.
Not at this portion of the game. We're not looking for laughs. We have the creature now coming out of Gaia's neck, and Michael came up with the idea of one of the trident pieces on the back of the creature is actually piercing through her jaw and coming out of her mouth. So she really looks like she's in peril and she's getting destroyed by this creature. From the get-go, I came up with the idea of doing the first-person kill and giving a new perspective on Kratos' kill sequences. And Michael took the idea and ran with it.
When you defeat Poseidon as his horrible watery self, you corner him down here in his humanoid form, and that's when you have to kill him off.
Immediately, everybody was just like sold once they saw it in-game. Yeah.
There was a lot of skeptics, too, as far as people come up to me, and I'm sure Adam too, and what are you doing? And then actually seeing it in a game, then everybody comes over and says like, all right, it worked.
Kratos is not so good at making friends, but he's good at killing people.
This boss battle has to end with a big, big finisher. And our final kill is where we're testing out these new CS moves of first person kills. So the minigame inputs right now are in a third person camera. And then when you succeed, you get to see the impact of Kratos' attacks and see how Poseidon feels as he's getting completely torn up. He just screams really loud and then bites his ear. It's more of a nibble than a bite.
So last time we checked him out, it was just the grayscale, high-res ZBrush version, and I believe the low-poly version as well. So since then, we've messed with water technology stuff, trying to make it look more like water's flowing through him. Help from like our art director, Ken, and other people trying to make the water look good. Generally though, water's pretty hard to do. It's just a combination of normal maps that scroll. Like we take UVs and have them scroll, as well as parallax maps, which add the distortion, which makes it feel like it's a little deeper. After we do all the fights, get it designed, and seeing what you really see and what you really don't. And then we might have to adjust stuff from there, you know?
Poseidon is doing well right now. We've been working on it for I don't know how many months, but where we are right now is every part of the boss fight and every part of the level has a first pass right now. It's in, it's functioning. I could hand you a controller and you can play through it. Tuning-wise, it might be too hard. The animations might be placeholder, but it's there. And we have people internally play testing it. So there's people who around here picked up the controller, played it, and been like, oh, wow, this sucks, or this is awesome. And then we keep tuning it and playing around with it to that.
We have meetings every week now, so we constantly see how much there is to do. And I mean, it's close as far as gameplay wise. It's all there. But doing stuff on the Titans has proven to be very challenging. So things that would usually take 5 minutes take 2 hours. All things considered, all the crazy shit we're doing in there, we've had to make hardly any, if any, concessions, which is pretty amazing because the scope of this thing is just huge.
This is when we finally get the reveal of Poseidon in his big, giant, epic form. So you find out that these creatures you're fighting are just part of this one, basically the ocean pulled up to Mount Olympus. Oh, Poseidon's broken.
There you go. That's how you know it's in development.
In development. And the water's supposed to be moving here and all that.
He's got no arms.
He's got no arms. You know, we have to polish this. We have to make this robust and bug-free, which that's the really scary part. But it's getting there.
When we first saw Poseidon, we were visiting the studio in Santa Monica and working with Stig, and it just blew us away that the whole screen was filled with this boss. I don't think there's ever been a boss as big as this boss. We're actually right in the midst of scoring it with Mike Regan, and it's gonna be huge. We're gonna pull out all the stops, 20 brass players, 53 string players, massive amounts of percussion. So we're really gonna try to create a kind of a cinematic unfolding experience for that whole first gigantic boss fight.
I hope that they're just blown away by just something they'd never seen before in a game. And that's my ultimate goal when I'm making games, is like hopefully to make something that people haven't experienced, and that makes your game really stick out.
The moment that I really got to play through that Poseidon level at the beginning of the game, and you remember how excited I was, like really kind of like when we first got the assets together and like we could sit down and play the things. And you could see, like, with the polish and everything, how amazing it was going to be. And that's it for me right there.
You have disrespected the gods for the last time, Kratos.
Programmer's role in the game is to help make everything a reality.
We make tools that allow the designers and artists to actually make the game.
If the designers want to do something or the artists want to do something, if they're smart, they'll consult us and ask, can we do this? And often we'll say no, and then they'll say we want to do it, and then we'll have to do it.
You give it to them, they give it to you, say what's wrong. Then you give it back to them a little bit different, and then they say, no, no, no.
Designers are pretty modest in their requirements. Designers are artists. They want the world.
The biggest challenge we face for this round of the game is content. The amount of content we need to put into a PS3 game is just order of magnitude is bigger than we had to put into a PS2 game. And to drive that content around the studio, we just face, you know, massive challenges.
We've got a little line emitter here, and it's got these particles, and it squirts them out to the right. And they get to a certain age, and they die. And one of the things we can do is we can change color of the particle over its lifespan. Starting from bottom to top, these particles start off blue, then go green, then turn red. Now, if I was an artist, I'd make them go like orange to black to whatever to express the effect that they want to. For me, I'm a programmer, so the nice, simple programmer graphics, nice, bright, solid, simple colors so that I can see when things go wrong. If I run this within Maya, then it runs the tool code that I wrote, which is this stuff, to display on the dev kit. And hopefully, so you can see, they're never going to create anything quite like this, because this is horrendous programmer stuff. But they'll take this tech, and what they'll do is they'll make fire pots or lava that flows. Anything that's best rendered by creating lots of little primitives and moving them all en masse in slightly different ways that aren't just pre-baked.
This is the soul tech. These are Hades souls swimming down the River Styx. Right now, they're above the River Styx, so I can see them all because the River Styx hasn't been properly watered yet. It was my task here to get them to follow the river along a bendy spline path and then ultimately to attack you. But I haven't done that part yet. Right now I'm just at the basic stage of getting them to swim down the river. The way that I did that was allow the Maya splines to be used and imported into the game, and then allow the designers to specify radii at different points of the curve. So at this point of the curve, the souls will be within that radius, and then they come as they come along the curve, they'll all be within this smaller radius, and then they can spread back out later here. And this is placed within the canyon just by the file structure. This loop here handles every soul. It updates all 30 of them.
QA stands for quality assurance, and what we do is we play through the game all day and find out the bugs that are going in the game and report them to all the different various production leads and creative leads around the office and make sure that everything gets fixed and there's not any big issues with the game when it ships.
It's our responsibility to make sure the game is appropriately awesome and epic.
If there is a big problem area, well, one of us will just like play that area all day long, every day, do everything you can imagine that could break the game, kind of get in the mind of what people playing for the first time, because we play it every single day. Try to do everything possible in that area with every item, every spell, and make sure it's all working and none of that's crashing the game. So this is the kind of stuff we test on before art even gets in. As you see, it's just kind of like some sheets, some blocks. You don't really see a lot. It's a pretty basic level. So you might see a level go from something like this. When it actually gets its art in, it looks a lot different. The spikes look a lot better, the walls have much more designs, you have the wood in the background, and it goes from designer chic to something more pretty like this. And this tells you what level we're currently in. The red one is the one you're in, the blue one is the one that you're going to, the one that's loading in, and the white one is the one that you came from. It's very easy when you're writing up a bug to tell them which area it's happening in. These say any AI that are loaded in, so if any of those are loading in and out, we can tell which one's causing problems or causing the game to crash. Over here you have your coordinates, which is just where you are on XYZ axis. It's useful for the artists because they can just type it in, and if we say there's no collision, there's a tree that Kratos is walking through, they don't really play the game very much, the artists, because they're constantly doing art. Down here, it's basically just frame rate, which is useful when we got one into the E3 demo. We use that a lot, and going to the final build, we'll be going through and documenting the frame rate everywhere and making sure everything is up to the right level of frame rate. We can see what areas are causing the frame rate to dip, that we need to have code or anybody else go through and see if they can optimize that area.
So I've just submitted the bug, and now I'm gonna try to see if I can take a video of it actually happening to reproduce it. The bug is that sometimes Kratos just won't grab onto the ledge when he does the jump. And the bugs are assigned to different priorities, and certain ones we refer to as progression stoppers, which means that if a player were to run into this bug playing through the game, they would be unable to continue. And we categorize that as an A bug. It's the absolute highest priority. So I have to make very sure that the designer gets this particular bug so that they're able to fix it, because it's very, very serious. We get as many as 100 to 200 bugs per day during certain phases of production.
This is the opening level. This is when Gaia is climbing up Mount Olympus, and you're on the back of Gaia. Art was just added to this level, so you would try to run along different areas, make sure Kratos can't pass through the world, like right here. So in this case, I would go in and give the artist the coordinates to this certain location where Kratos is inside the rock, and that artist would make a collision pass, fixing that collision so I couldn't fall through it. I'm loading the test level to test the Wraith. It's basically this enemy that burrows underground. And the only way you can actually attack him is to use the L1 and circle move, which is your grapple. When he's under the ground, I'm supposed to be able to grab him out and slam him on the concrete. But that's not working right now, so that's when I would open up my Test Track Pro and write up a bug report. It's our job to play the game over and over and over again. So after you play a certain section a certain amount of times, it gets a little repetitive, but that just comes along with the duties of being in QA.
It certainly takes some of the romance out of it, but it's a real pleasure being able to see the game evolve day by day, step by step, asset by asset as they are implemented. It's very exciting.
Not quite artists, close, but not quite. You know, some of us have artistic skills. But, we're not quite programmers either, although we do write code, right? Once again, not so much this guy.
And TechGuard helps make the stuff, and we help people use the stuff.
Because without us, nothing would get done. There's a huge gap between code, the engineering guys or the coders, and just regular artists. So we kind of bridge that gap.
Artists don't understand binary. When a programmer comes over and he's like 00101, it just goes one ear, in one ear and out the other, right?
Yeah, they think it's a phone number or something.
We have to invent things ourselves and come across certain lines that nobody has crossed before.
We're good at it though, right?
We're pretty good at it.
Yeah.
We've done so many crazy stuff in the past that there's nothing that surprises us anymore.
The artists were having trouble just building things. And their levels, the environment guys, just built huge, gigantic levels. Big, bigger than this guy.
High five.
And the levels themselves, they just get really big, and they only need working on a small section of it, just a little portion. And I wrote a tool that lets them pick which parts they want to use and export just that as a level. And to get that, they just came to me with a problem.
They wanted to exaggerate Kratos and the torture that he does to his enemies. So we came up with a system called the Zipper Tech, where basically the animator would use controls to open up wherever the cut is on the character. The character artists would model out wherever the cut will take place, and we'll put the rig on top of that. So here we have the Centaur rig and the Zipper Tech. The Centaur's guts are going to be opened up. And so basically the animator would go in and create the CS move. You can go in and individually select these controls and open and close his gut. Here we have the guts for the Centaur. They're gonna be part of the props. The animator will go in and animate these guts spilling out of the Centaur. And so the guts will be placed in and around here. And to further sell the point, we've got separate controls over here in the middle where you can actually pull out the insides.
From God of War 2 to God of War 3, we've used dynamic simulation more and more to do more secondary animations on the characters, whereas before on, you know, the previous games, you know, the hair would be stiff or the cloth would be stiff. They would be kind of modeled into the creatures. Now we're actually adding motion to those pieces. So you will see hair kind of moving, you'll see cloth kind of moving.
Towards the end of the previous game, I had, in collaboration with Jason Minters, had created this dynamic system that uses the Maya hair system to drive a series of joints. So as you can see, each of the snakes on her head are independently moving. The animator did not have to individually pose all of these animations, but they have control over the physics so that they can get it to get into a pose that they want, but still when the character moves around, you'll see how the snakes will flow backwards when she goes forwards. It responds to movement, so it improves a lot of the workflow for the animators. It's pretty rewarding to see as characters go from our department through the rest of the pipeline and then come back and actually see it in the game.
So what I received here is a model of Kratos. What I'm doing is adding the wrinkle in his facial expressions. It's being driven by the actual joints in his skeleton. So as you can see, as I lower the joints, his wrinkles go away, and just like a real human, as the joints move up, the wrinkles start to show up on his face. That's some of the new technology that we're putting into the characters and Kratos. Here I have another example. If I lower his shoulder, you can see veins start popping out and striations start popping out on his shoulder. So not only are we putting this technology into his face, but it's also gonna be in his body. In the beginning, Yuri kind of got a little freaked out when he got the project because, you know, it was one of those things where it was like, okay, you need to work on this thing, this tail, crazy tail rig that will do everything that we need to get done in this game. There's four of us on the team and we all kind of took a stab at it. And, you know, it was kind of an iterative thing, but Yuri definitely solved the problem.
What we see here is the battle between Kratos and Medusa, and Medusa's trying to constrict Kratos. The idea the rig can do dependent and independent motions. You can rotate one section at a time, I can move one control at a time. So now, for example, here, I'm affecting this part of the rig, and I'm also affecting controls that are right next to it. Things are stretching, and things stay in place or not.
I think the key to it is that it's, for an animator, it's very easy to use. We can use it on many types of different creatures, tails, ropes, hair.
In God of War 2, there was a creature, Kraken, and that thing had huge tentacles. And Matty, he was lead animator and game lead animator back then. He animated it, and he complained a lot. And after he saw this rig, and after he saw what guys were doing with Medusa, every time I walk by him, he just thanks me for making this thing.
UI is user interface, anything that's not game related, so menus and meters and combo numbers and all that good stuff.
The hallmark of a good UI, I would say, is making sure that when the player goes through the menus, that they're able to navigate pretty easily and understand where everything is. And when instructions come up, we want to make sure that they're there and they're clear and they're obvious, but they don't kind of interfere with the gameplay.
This is what we refer to as the shell. It's the kind of like the intro to the game. Currently, it's our alpha version, so it's somewhat simple, but basically we have a skybox in the background. You can see the clouds animating. This is the real Kratos model. We're actually calling an animation to the character. So when you choose a new game, you get a submenu, and you can choose if you want to play an easy, normal, or hard. Very hard is locked out in the beginning. So you can see that when I choose a game, you'll see like the camera pan into Kratos' face, and then a video starts up. So all of that has to be hand-coded.
So this is the basis of the Pandora's box, the menu system that we have in-game. So it's a full 3D model, and then I get that into the UI and do everything that needs to be done to make it work. So tag it with all the tags it needs, text elements, things like that. So all these kind of proxy quads we have in here all represent a line of text that shows up in the game. We pretty much start off on this demon face side, and we zoom up real close to frame it so that it's kind of more 2D looking. This would be the power-up menu. So you go to this menu, and you upgrade your weapons, and you know, you're able to kind of zoom into the models and rotate them around. At least that's what we're hoping. So we won't make it for alpha, but we're gonna shoot for beta. You can swap between menus by, you know, hitting R1 and L1. And that rotates the camera around the box to another side. And then we frame another side of the box and put information for like the items menu. So this is the items menu. Top of the box is the status screen. So that's, you know, how many kills you have and all that good stuff. And then we push through into the box to get to the moves list. And then, you know, it goes in kind of like this cycle. So you can cycle through all of these menus in order. So pretty much what you're seeing here is the Pandora's box. And then from here you go, you know, you swap to other screens, and we have all these kind of cool little animations going on. And eventually inside of these screens there'll be much more ancillary animations and things going on. This time around, for God of War 3 anyways, we completely switched our system up. This time it's all 3D. The same shaders that we put on game objects we use in the UI. So it opens up a whole new avenue of what we can do. It also opens up a whole new set of problems, so.
Most definitely.
Some of the problems we ran into creating the shell is using the character animation system that we have developed to animate the parts of the shell, specifically the menus. Surprisingly enough, it doesn't work that well. It works well for characters, but not well for the stuff that we need to do. So we had to add a lot of new tech to the system in order to get it working.
Richard's pretty new to the UI. I mean, Richard's been here for a while at the studio, but he's just recently started helping me with the UI stuff, and so having him as a second set of eyes for this whole system has been really helpful. And he's a really technical guy, so has a good rapport with coders, so he can get more done than I can sometimes.
Yeah, it's funny because Corey will go down there and he'll ask them to do something, and they're like, no, and then, no, I'm just kidding.
We're kind of the bridge between the ideas that Stig and the designers come up with and different 3D departments. We help visualize it on paper, painting it up, drawing it up in 2D, and then they take that and actually make the assets for the game.
You have to come up with cool design with limited of time. The design also has to make sense to art director, game director, the lead artist. So it's definitely fun, but it's stressful.
What's usually given to us is a quick description and then sometimes a write-up on whatever that creature or character has to do, their function in game. And there's always sort of a highlight on special abilities or things that we need to focus on.
There's only four concept artists here. We all sit together, so we do get to see what we're doing.
I feel like I should know a lot more about Greek mythology by now. I should have my PhD degree or something.
Yeah.
But still, a lot of times, I just sort of make up a lot of things, and this is still a lot of fun.
Right now, as you could see on my monitor,
Working on Pandora's cage, this is a final concept design that was approved and it's good to go. But to get to this point, there was a lot of sketches, a lot of color variation, a lot of input that I had to get through. We've tried maybe girls hanging together, or we tried maybe girls holding the fire torch, or we even tried the guys holding a cube, or we even tried the guys holding the torch. So after all this variation, the one got picked, which was this. This two character is Icarus. Because I mainly focus on environment, I took a lot of pictures of myself. Actually, it was my wife took it for me last night. It's kind of embarrassing to show, but I'm wearing my boxers and just shirt. Just trying to come up with the pose that I want, even the back part, the front side, and even the hands. So a little frustrating because I do environment paintings, which deals with a lot of rectangles and cubes and, you know, where the light is gonna hit and all that. But when it comes to character, it's more organic. For me, it's more difficult.
It's palace for the gods. These are the basic thumbnails I showed to director. Then from here, we start to bring in all these location elements where each portion of the buildings are representing different levels. It's not just figuring out the entire look of the place. I also have to figure out how each sections are connected. Actual elevation of the location and how it's connected has to be pretty accurate. Every time I do a second pass on the concept, it raises so many questions again. Feedback means change, and after that, it raises different questions, and another meeting, and feedback again, and changes. So it started with a very ambitious and very inspired task, and then slowly became a big headache. But the funny thing is, you never get to see this scale in actual game, because actual gameplay only takes place in this top section here. Like you see, this entire concept is being drawn out from the entire mountain towards the balcony area where the most gameplay is take place.
One of my most favorite tasks was to create Aphrodite, the goddess of love. My chore, as it were, was to create the most beautiful woman that ever existed in Greek mythology. Here I've got some initial sketches. There's a lot of Greek art that involves, you know, sort of the bare breast and things like that. So we were trying to come up with a way of framing these really feminine aspects of this character without being like just vulgar. I originally had her hair always bound up, very Greek-like, but they really wanted it hanging down. This is the final three-quarter view of Aphrodite. As you can see, some of the stuff that I had originally concepted in the other pieces did stay. One of the mandates for the character was that she have a girdle made by Hephaestus. Some of the backstory is that Aphrodite was given as a wife to Hephaestus by Zeus. In original Greek mythology, she cheats on Hephaestus by bedding down with Ares, the god of war, the original god of war. He punishes her by catching her in a trap with Ares and sort of parades the two of them in front of the other gods to shame them. And she was ashamed. She's a naughty girl. But in our story, he just kept her trapped. We've got various somewhat sexy bondage-y entrapments that we've worked up. So the modelers will take this and build, you know, Aphrodite in the flesh. And I must say, I'm really looking forward to see what they do with it.
Do you know how long it's been since a real man has come into my chambers? Those bridges outside are nearly destroyed. Zeus refuses to have that stupid mortal Daedalus stop working on his precious labyrinth to fix them.
I'm Max Ankar, the senior effects artist, and working on God of War 3. This is my new helper or friend. Hold on. Let's restart that.
I speak in clicks.
Okay, wait, hold on. Ready? This is my partner, Jesse Cheese Whiz. That's all I can say. I'm working on God of War 3 here, making the greatest effects. Got a partner now, Jesse. He's awesome. It's gonna be great having some help on God of War 3. And yeah, cool. I looked on the internet and find out all these different movie special effects, kind of duplicated what they did. We filmed the blood and the idea that maybe we could use some of it for textures.
Spray instead of the last one just it leaking out. This one should spray like kind of like more like an artery.
Oh, that's pretty great.
Yeah.
What we found out, the simplest one was just like kind of like a water bottle with filled up with movie blood, and that kind of gave them almost best squirting effect out of all the blood.
We got some good blood today. I know my partner here, Jesse, sacrificed a lot to help out. He donated the blood for us, and I'm really glad we had Jesse here to help us out.
He's sweet.
Yeah, Jesse's really good. Sorry. Jesse, watch out, okay? Thank you.
We used a couple little parts of it right here. This is the film blood. You got a series of images that you rendered out. You put those on the polygonal cards, and that's what you're throwing out of the particle system, basically, or splatting on the ground. That's kind of what's going around in the game, is a little blood splatters when Kratos gets hit or enemies get hit.
This recording session for God of War that we're starting today is the culmination of a lot of preparation. This is definitely the most complicated session I've ever put together.
I'm gonna go get a sweatshirt.
We should go in the other room while we can, huh?
One of you here and one of you here.
How close do you need to be? Here, just duck under the microphone. We need to take a couple minutes to readjust where things are. I'm a little nervous about this session, just the number of variables. We've got a lot going on. Two actors at a time, we've got a lot of people gonna be at the session. We've got facial capture, we've got teleprompters, we've got all kinds of stuff. It's a new studio. There's room for error, but I like to think that I've nailed everything down before we got there, but I'm definitely, my breath's coming a little shorter today than it normally does. We are moments away.
What was it, Kratos?
All I remember is what I have lost.
That is why you should give me the power. I understand its true meaning. And
my character, I like to think of her as she thinks she's doing something good, but in reality, she's trying to take over the world.
Kratos, she is the key to our revenge. I trust you to do the right thing, Kratos.
You shouldn't.
Kratos, I found out, is a piece of me that I kind of didn't know existed. It's kind of a dark side that it really is fun getting a chance to explore.
I delivered your revenge on Zeus.
My vengeance ends now. I owe you nothing!
When you have the other actor in the room, you're able to come up with a rhythm, it makes it more real.
I really, really like it. It gives you a chance to play off of what the other person is doing as opposed to doing it by yourself.
We're getting so much from this performance that we wouldn't normally get. I'm totally stoked about it right now.
You owe me this, Kratos!
I owe you nothing!
Bravo, that's perfect.
Awesome.
Excellent.
That was it,
I knew you'd come back.
I've never worked with the prompters, and it's really freeing for the actor because, you know, you're looking straight ahead instead of always, you know, face down in the page, and it's really a cool experience.
Find the labyrinth! Ah! Ah! Please! Help! Kratos!
One of my favorite things to do is scream. I really, I like, I don't know why. Maybe, no, I don't know why. I saw Zeus torture my father. I just try really a simple approach to it. It's bringing those words into your character and actually thinking a thought before it. It makes it more real.
They called me a monster.
Beautiful.
Natalie was new. We had never worked with her before. She was an ace. She totally knocked it out of the park.
Many more variables than a normal voiceover session for a game today. And it went very, very well. I'm happy with how today turned out.
It's phenomenal. Phenom.
That's all that really matters is Stig is happy. And if Stig's happy, we're all happy.
Who is Hercules? Well, it was me for 7 years on TV, so this is a whole different look. I didn't quite have that look. I had kind of more gear on, and I didn't weigh, you know, 4,000 pounds. This guy's like about 12 feet tall.
They called them labors. Ha!
There you go.
That was good. That was really good. Yeah. Kevin Sorbo was obviously an easy choice because he's Hercules, but not necessarily in terms of the way that he's played Hercules in the past, a little bit of a departure. Can we get but this kind of brother?
Yeah, more
intense. More seething.
But this time, brother, this time I will destroy you.
That's good.
In this game, he's a much darker brute. He's not the brightest light bulb out there, but at the same time, when it comes to war, he's brilliant.
The direction is more pissed.
Okay. As pissed as you can get.
The most valuable I can be is to take what the creator of the game has been imagining and seeing on paper for a long time and bringing it to life with the voice and trying to find different ways to get to actors to achieve what he wants to do. Try one thing, if you would, Kevin.
Yeah.
Take the breath after stables and then you can finish off the phrase.
Okay.
The most frustrating thing about doing voiceover is the amount of time you've got to do each line. You've got to repeat it, but you've got to also do it in so many different ways, so many different inflections, and you end up losing your voice.
Have you not killed enough of your family?
That's good.
That's very good. It was a slam dunk. He really brought a passion to the character. He was very professional. His voice was kind of running out. That's when he gave some of his best stuff.
Fantastic.
Beautiful.
Yay.
Thank you. It wasn't the same Hercules, not even close to it. So it was a darker, more sinister person and more evil person to deal with and play. But, you know, from my standpoint, it was a lot of fun.
It's a way to start.
New day of recording, very excited about it. Today we're doing Rip Torn and Malcolm McDowell. The game's based on Greek mythology. This guy's like the Smith god, and he's
always
like...
Always the Vulcan.
Yes, that's exactly.
The Roman name for Hephaestus is Vulcan. He's the god of fire, and he's a great blacksmith. The greatest thing you have on stage is the other actor.
I don't get extra pay for this.
Thank you. They are entertainment, and they are movies, and you can get involved in it. It kind of gives you a semblance of what live theater used to be when you had audience participation.
Yeah, I kind of look like that.
Ghost of Sparta.
It is you. Well, well, well. I thought Zeus would have killed you by now.
Davis.
Oh, I'm about to see you.
He's the inventor. He also created the labyrinth.
Labyrinth? Wow. Where is the golf course?
It's really cool. Eat lunch with Malcolm McDowell. I can't beat that.
The ice storm, that will give me the power to bring my son back to me.
Where is my boy?
That's awesome.
You bastards!
That was awesome.
We want to protect it with one more, please.
Oh, we're not going to go protecting all these takes, are we?
Yeah,
don't
we
tell
are.
Me we're going to do two fucking takes. Why don't you just use a bit of proper tape? You're going to. Why do we have to do two takes of everything?
Well, because we...
Not for protection.
Yeah.
Oh, come on.
Let's listen to it.
That's nonsense.
Yeah, we're going to listen to one line, be right with you.
Okay. You don't mind, right? Because it's really, if I'm in a jag and it's going, it's going.
I hear you. Could we do the line to escape it, please, one
yes.
more time?
Tell me what you need.
The word catalyst had a little bit of a squirtle to it.
Okay.
Okay. When you're ready.
Okay. To escape it, we must assemble it.
Actors are so varied and so different in the way they work, and to find what that key in there is and unlock that door with them and then be able to play is really a challenge and a kick at the same time.
He said that if I took the liquid fire and the sling, oh, my boy, oh, my child.
You know, I actually
great.
Like that. That's different than what we thought.
Terrific, thank you.
I like it.
Vengeance on the king of gods. You'll need an army of gods. And weapons, of course, weapons. I could build, I could use the fire of Hades. Wait, please. Please, wait, free me. Free me from my torture.
We're good, we're good.
Thank you, Spot. Thanks, Spartan, I say
cheers, sir.
I say squatter.
We're not used to people coming in here and nailing it so, like, basically knocking it out of the park like this. So
oh, really?
We had more time, so.
Well, no, okay. Well, listen, I just thought, oh, my God, I thought I had reams and reams and I had to do everything twice. Yeah. And it was like, oh, my God, if you've got it, you've got it, right?
Right. Yeah, we got some great stuff.
Great.
Yeah. It's fantastic.
Terrific.
Good.
Thank you. My pleasure. To work with Malcolm McDowell and Rip Torn in the same day.
Same day, yeah.
Pretty wild experience.
Yeah.
It's fascinating to me, too, the different acting styles, because Malcolm McDowell's very much the Royal Shakespeare Company, and it comes in, you know, word for word like that. And Rip Torn is more of the old actor's studio, and he's a little bit up and down and nowhere, but out of that comes a gold of its own kind.
There's an extra level of dimension and texture that we got to them that's just through the fact that they're fucking good actors.
Now that we've gotten the recording part of it down, my stress level has decreased a great deal.
Now you can have a glass of wine.
Now I can have a glass of wine.
You are the reason I live in torment.
He told me he would kill you.
He can't. Perhaps he did allow me to kill the Nemean Lion, but he made your name known amongst the people. A fierce warrior, a killer made a hero, a man made a god.
But you, what have you done with my child? My boy, where is my boy?
Your son is dead, Davis.
My boy, my child, no. No! No!